day to everyone. I don't know what time it is, so it's either afternoon or morning. I know most of you, but I'm Neil Heffey for the ones that I don't know. And basically, we started a group like this last year, which was Albien Law. A group of us, there was about six of us that basically got started and moving down the line with a different number of issues. And it comes to it that a few of us are pretty good at law and reading through the statutes so we can explain it to people. And we found that that's more where we've moved on to now, which is why we've stopped the group. Now, we basically recommend that a lot of people start these groups because it's only from the coming together of people that, you know, we can make a change. Standing alone, we're isolated, you know, we're not protected, and the law is not there for us. So this is a presentation where we're working together to promote freedom and social justice with Dignity Alliance, and we're going to be talking about council tax and liability orders. Right, so basically my journey into this is I was a project manager of a building company for about 6 years, doing new builds, restaurants, wine bars, etc., and dealing with the council in a number of planning issues. I became a property management agent in about 2008 when the market was going into recession due to the banks, but that's another story. And that led me to gathering properties together and looking at what was going on with the rental issues that was on them, the non-payments, defaults, etc. I came from a business angle essentially, and was looking at the problems that a lot of the tenants were having with the councils. For the first part of it, I basically was going around and collecting the rents and dealing with issues, wondering why payments weren't made. It took me some time to figure out that a lot of the problem was lying with the councils, not putting payments into place when they should be doing, not dealing with claims that are put in. Basically, I set up a structure where we assisted tenants in completing the housing benefit forms, a full pack, advising them what they needed so as to put the claim, because I'm not a landlord that I don't like to collect money and top-ups from people that are on benefits and are already suffering with low income. So we dealt with claims for them so as the housing would make the full payments that they were entitled to in June. The council didn't like this. Now, this is where the journey began for me. Basically, I started to receive a lot of council tax bills in my name for properties I don't own but I manage, or properties I don't own and I don't manage. It appears if Liverpool City Council can't find whoever owns a property, they put it in my name. I must have at least 1,000 liability orders in my name, and I've gone through 6 years. I know they don't exist. Having to prove that is a different matter. So I've spent quite a considerable amount of time in the courts trying to obtain justice, basically going in with arguments of what's right, what's wrong, standing there thinking, well, I'm right, you know, it's clear as day, I don't need to do anything. The judge is going to be fair, he's going to be impartial, he's not going to show bias, and this case should just get thrown out. What a joke. So, realising I'm a strong character, I assert myself with a lot of people, and in business I have to run and manage a lot of staff. I run a number of companies, some of them are not my own, but I do them for other people and investors, etc. So basically, going on from that, I started to find that a lot of my tenants were having difficulties, and I had two choices, either chase the tenants or chase the council. It was deciding who was in the wrong, and to me, in every instance, it was the council. Yeah. They was just completely causing misery, wreaking havoc across Liverpool in the areas that I managed properties, and I soon found on the internet that there was a lot of other counties that were suffering from the same problem. It seems to be an orchestrated attack on people that are within this country.
Yeah, yeah.
So I had plenty of frustration, as you can all aware. Who else has had frustration? Is that about everyone? I took the free man route for a while, unsure of what the common law was meaning. I was standing, making all them assumptions and presumptions and trying to remove them and implied rights, etc. And I had a bit of a lack of understanding about what the common law was and how to apply it. So I studied law. I basically went through all of the legislation, started to read their rules. When they're making a claim, they'll put that you've committed some offence contrary to such and such a legislation. Well, that legislation will say what the offence is, but then there's how they apply that legislation to you. So you've got to look at how they're doing that. There's more to than just the legislation that they're quoting to you. So legal remedies that are available in the court, you can make civil claims for trespass, torts, conversion, malicious communications, harassment. Basically, the next part of it was is that you can take a prosecution. There's fraud, misrepresentation, abuse of position, you know, all the documents that have just been shown this morning, all of them look fraudulent to me. I've gone through the civil procedure rules and the criminal procedure rules to identify what orders need to have to make them official and how they are invalid, and that you've got to use that law and quote it, because if they know you don't know it, they will not give you the rights or the remedy. The most effective thing I think you can do in the court, if you're suffering where they're actually going to come to your property and they're threatening with the bailiffs, etc., is to apply for either a civil injunction or a criminal restraining order. Now, for that, you would have to detail an argument and supply evidence that the documents are fraud and alleged. That would then be your claim, and it would be on them to prove that basically they had the right to come forward and do this to you without you making them applications and asserting your rights. That's why that they can act the way that they do and how they can get away with this, because there's no oversight, there's no judicial scrutiny, there's no one there to protect you. The police aren't there to protect you, they're there to protect the bailiffs and the corporations and ensure that the government receives its money. Yeah.
Sorry, Neil, what was those two procedures just? I've got them.
Which ones?
I
went about 20.
Apply for a what, sorry?
A criminal restraining order or a civil injunction.
A civil injunction?
Yeah. If you're going to do a criminal prosecution, you'd go for a criminal restraining order, because you'd be gathering the evidence together and basically you'd be able to identify that a crime's being committed and you want a restraining order to stop them proceeding with their actions pending your introduction or laying of the complaint or the information or indictments, whichever way that you choose to do it. So what we do is we've set up a company called Albien Law Advocates Limited, where basically we assist people for free. We will look to obtain cost orders from the courts. We're getting a group together because there's too many individuals that's going around and trying to do this on their own. And the work that is involved in bringing a prosecution or a case requires investigation, requires documented, drafted arguments, requires things exhibit. And the reason why a lot of people are failing is because they're running to the court with a piece of paper, they're laying in information, they're putting down the facts, and then everything else is in their head. And they're trying to explain that and express it and appeal to someone who hasn't got emotion, using emotion to try and get reason with them. There's no reasoning in the courts. It's corrupt. And there's no explanation as to why or how. So basically, we set this up because the legal aid's been withdrawn with a lot of people. Seeing that I personally have helped a lot of people out in court cases, and I've found that a lot of people are suffering. They're in terrible situations where the courts are not offering them no remedy. There's no protection from the police. The bailiffs don't care. They're acting just on a phone call that's received from the council telling them to go out and do it. I mean, the bailiffs and the police, you could compare them with dogs. Yeah. They're just like, throw a bone and go and fetch. Solicitors are £300 an hour. And the problem with that is £300 an hour is wasted on cups of tea, cups of coffee, going to the toilet, they're running the clock, and they're not giving you any results, they're not documenting evidence, they're not fighting your corner, and they're making it very easy for the courts to stamp all over your rights. Yeah. There are very poor results that's in there.
Conflict of interest with it.
Oh, very, very much so. It's a conflict of interest in a number of ways, you know. And they're all members of the bar. But to be fair with solicitors, they're prisoners just like us. You know, it's just that you hear a lot of people saying, "I'm only doing my job," right? And that seems to be the common response to anyone claiming that they've got a grievance with someone that's attacking them. And to be honest, they are only doing the job. They're looking after their families, just like everyone else is trying to do their jobs. The police are the same. The last time I met a police officer that knew the law, well, I have never have. So I can't say the last time. So we have a law library. I've created the law library with over 2,000 books for basically people in the public to come in, to have a look, to research law, get involved where they can, to help them or assist them. You know, it's in an office, it's open every day, there's businesses run there. I personally work there from about 6 in the morning till about 9 at night, 7 days a week. So it's open all the time. The use of the Human Rights Act, we promote the use of that because not so much some people will disagree and some people will say it's acts and this, that and the other. That is what they're saying, that they are given to everyone in this room. So you can basically make the claim that they're breaching that, but it is not an easy task to do. Is where people fail is, again, you look at the Human Rights Act and they'll look at the articles, and the articles will say what you're entitled to, but then there will be schedules which say how you enforce that, and there will be other legislation that you will have to pair with it to enforce it. And this is why people aren't getting the remedy or the success that they need in the courts, because they're sort of picking up half-cocked arguments and then running into court and saying, no, I found this, and you know, the court recognise people who know what they're talking about and people that don't know what they're talking about. It doesn't necessarily mean that they're still going to comply with the rule of law, because to comply with the rule of law, we wouldn't even have half of these courts, because they're completely unlawful, the way that they operate, the way that they're employed, and the way that they act against people. You've also got the European Convention of Human Rights, which is basically a mirror image of the Human Rights Act. It's got a little bit more in it than the Human Rights Act. The Human Rights Act is a watered-down version of the European Convention of the Human Rights. Now, the International Bill of Human Rights is basically above the two of them, and that's what is signed by all the treaties, Treaty of Rome, Treaty of Versailles, and so on. There's so many of them, but this is the UK and other countries being a signatory to a document promising to treat their peoples with respect and to give them this assistance. The problem what we've got is getting to enforce that means you've got to go to the European Court, and there is a couple of European courts, so it's not an easy task. And before you can go there, you've got to, even though you know, I've failed on a few occasions by thinking, okay, well, I don't want to go to the magistrates, I don't want to go to the Crown, I don't need to go there. Now I'm looking at the High Court, that's just as corrupt. I don't want to go there. What's the point in going there when you're not going to get any justice? Forward to the next step and the next step. The problem is they won't let you in at the top until you've exhausted all your remedies. So what they're trying to do is wear us down, right? Is wear us down to show us you're not going to get any justice, to try and stop us getting to the top. I haven't personally got to the top yet, so I don't know whether there's justice there. Now, the last bit, which is not shown on the slide, is the covenants on civil and political economic rights. That is basically enforced via use of the United Nations Charter, which would be on the... So what's wrong with the court? The costs. You've changed all the format of this, haven't you? Trying to give me a challenge here.
He did his pupillage with Neuberger.
It's overpaid staff in the court. And that, by that, is meaning the district judges there. Each district judge I know of in Merseyside is on a minimum salary of £101,000 for working between 10 and 4 in the day. They don't really do anything. They're sort of like that little nodding dog that sits on the dashboard of a car. You know, they got outsourced on the security, which all these costs are all incurred by us, because we are their customers. So when they're dragging us in there, and now instead of employing some security that's going to work in and they're going to pay someone a salary, they're outsourcing it to the likes of G4 or Serco, who are charging massive amounts of money, which is why court costs are through the roof and access to justice is being refused to a lot of people as a result. Yeah. They're outsourcing admin. They've got large expense accounts. They're ill-treated victims. And by that, I mean the people that are getting called in there as the accused or the defendants, as they'd say. And victim surcharges. Especially when there isn't a victim, that itself is fraud, is it not? You know, what's a victim surcharge? There's lawlessness in there, it's bias, there's incompetency, unwilling to listen, they're incapable of emotion, they've got a lack of common sense, it's privately owned, it's run as a business, and it's got bad management. And they're the main problems with the court. Because I personally, well, you know, I think I've caught them all, but there's probably a lot more than that. I'm trying to summarise.
What do you think?
How do you summarise such a bad organisation?
Well, apart from this, it's a pretty good system.
Well, if it was run the way it should be, it could be, because the problem is not the system. They're making us believe it is the system. The system is there for our protection. It's not there for our oppression. It's just that because we have been ignorance in ourselves to education, because it's not something that they teach us in school. It's not something they teach us unless you specifically request it, and then they're giving you specific directions of how you to do it. What happens to men being able to think for themselves, or women being able to think for themselves, being able to apply thought, common sense? Yeah.
Where is the beginning of the lie then?
Where's the beginning of the lie?
Yeah. From where does it all stem from? How
misuse of the law? The law is there to protect people.
We have to go to the origin. How this we are up against has evolved to this monstrous level.
But you tell me, how does that fix? Knowing where the origin is will not create a solution. All that's going to tell us is that the system's terrible. Well, we know that. We can move on. What we've got to look at is how can we obtain justice in the system, and how can we make a difference and highlight it to people in a language that they understand? Because I now understand the legalese language. I can speak the Latin language that the solicitors speak in court. I can use all the paraphrases that they use. I can use all the rules, and I can do the interpretations and read through the interpretation acts. But that itself, it is deceitful, and everyone knows it. You look at some of the words and the way they interpret it, and you think, oh, does that mean that? It's not right at all. The thing is all you've got to do is you're looking too far in to say, let's go back to the beginning and let's see what the origin of the problem was. What the problem is today, is now. It's not the past. It's that the system is there and we've got to learn how to use it. We've got to adapt as a group and share ideas and share knowledge. Because there was one Lord, I don't know which one it was, it might have been Lord Denning, who said that it would take a man 400 years just to read legislation, never mind understand it. So if it takes one man 400 years, there's no point in us trying to understand something that's not going to make a difference, because we've got limited time to make a change. They are already trying to push us out of the court, to restrict our access to it. Most hearings are done in people's absence. There's nothing you can do about it. But I'll take questions at the end, right, so as I get through, because this slide's going to be about an hour and a half of me going through. So after I've finished, then if anyone wants to ask any questions, I'll answer them as best I can. So what's the main alternative? Is to take the free man route. A lot of people have done that. I personally have done it. I've been successful with it. I've held them off. But it does end up landing a lot of people in problems and trouble. They ignore it. Those who don't research it properly end up in trouble. They end up going in with a half argument, and the judge will take them off the script that they've been given to see whether they understand it, and then they'll act anyway, because at the end of the day, there's no deterrence for the judges, because no one's managing to take a claim against them or to take a prosecution against them yet that I know of successfully. They continue to bully you, they'll brand you, and then there's a standoff. It's basically they'll deal with you in your absence, when you're not there, at the point where they know you know what you're talking about, they wait until you're gone, and then they'll make the judgment in your absence. So even if you are successful, they'll still skirt around it. The other alternative is to basically do nothing when it works. If you do nothing, you'll be fine. You can either pay and wait for the next attack. Don't pay and deal with thugs. Does anyone know what thugs I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Police and bailiffs. And then there's possible arrest and possible imprisonment. The facts and procedure in the court. The principles of defence that you have in accordance with Article 14 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights come from the common law. These are absorbed into the common law. So just because people might look and want and choose to opt for the common law, you've got to find where the common law is in the statute law. Because to me, as I now understand it, the statutory law is the code of common law. Common law is the law of reason. So it's where a reasoned judgment is made based upon what another man would expect a man to do, how we'd expect to live. The statute law is being broken, is like a codified version of the common law to describe what the elements of crimes are. So it makes it easier and more identifiable for people to assess what exactly the cause of action is that they've got, or what the crime is and what elements of that crime are needed. Now, the common law will strike out a statute law if the statute law is being misapplied. But you've got to use that for a reason, because you've got to me, you've got to step back to the very beginning, and you've got to say, well, okay, why was that statute law put into place? What was the reason behind it? Because there will be a good reason why statute was put there. What the problem is it's being manipulated and misused. So that's when you come in with your common law arguments on the basis that that law is being misused and it's unreasonable. Now, you can't just plead common law. You've then got to go to the case law, which is authorities, and you'll be trailing through endless judgments to try and find captions of a reasoned judgment. Because believe it or not, they have come up with some reasonable judgments in the past, and there is some common sense thinking. Not in this era, but going back, there was a lot of reasoned judgments and a lot of reasoned case law that supports and is still leading authorities today, which is binding on the courts. So the right to be tried without undue delay. Guy's been a victim of that one, haven't you, Guy? Mm-hmm. 6 months on, whatever it was.
Two years, was it?
And
then they dropped the case at the end, yeah.
You've also got the right to legal assistance, as long as you can afford it. You've got the right to be tried in one's presence, as long as you be quiet, sit down, and do as you're told. You've got the right to call witnesses and secure their presence in court, as long as it's not the person who's accusing you, like the counsel or the chief constable, as long as it's just someone, you know, who's just a normal person on the street like you or I. You've got the right to cross-examine prosecution witnesses. Again, the same goes for above. You've got the right to have the free service of an interpreter. Anyone going to court, I would advise them to exercise that right and ask for an interpreter on what the language is that they're speaking, because it sounds normal to you, but it isn't. So you want definitions of every word that they use. The right to remain silent in court is probably a good option. The right to appeal against conviction or sentence. The right to not to be tried or punished for an offence which one has previously been convicted or acquitted. And the right to bail pending trial appeal, subject to the gravity of the offence that's charged. So the right to a fair trial is basically explaining to you that you can put in your own evidence, you've got the right to assess all the evidence that they put in, everything that they're claiming that's been in has got to be disclosed to you unless it reaches the what they'll call public interest immunity, and that is very unusual for them to be able to obtain an order on that, and it's normally only done under the Terrorism Act. That's what that law was brought in for. It's basically to stop you obtaining like official copies of a liability order, but everything that they're going to refuse you must come with an order, so you can basically assert your rights and enforce it. A lot of people go to court and start putting in a lot of things and make 100 points, and this is where they get lost. You should pick your points one at a time and find the law that supports what your point is, and then ask the judge to come across with some reasoning in his judgment if he's going to refuse you, and then you have the grounds to appeal that judgment. Article 6 of the Human Rights Act imposes two obligations on the state. One of them is the negative obligation, and that's not to punish anyone without a fair trial. And the other is a positive obligation, and that's to establish a court system that upholds this right. The UK fail on both counts. Now, breaches of Article 6, this is where you can make a claim in accordance with your rights if they're breached. And these are closely linked with Articles 5, 7 and 13 of the Act, although I think 13 has recently been repealed. The principle that people will be heard and judged in court, that's where it first came from, was the Magna Carta, which set out that to no one will we sell, to no one will we refuse or delay the right to justice. Now that's an ancient principle of common law that still stands today. Much of the Magna Carta has been repealed. By what authority and whether that's lawful or not, I don't know. But I know that that right is still sitting in it. Now, there's the Bill of Rights in 1689, which set out a host of provisions and assurances in law, which basically stopped, it was to suspend the monarch from running tyranny over the people. So Parliament stepped in to create the Bill of Rights for the people to stop them doing that. What we've got now is the problem, is that, you know, Parliament are abusing that system themselves. So who's going to step in now? Because now the King or the Queen, as it were, the monarch, and Parliament are working together hand in hand. So there's no one there for our protection. The UK is a signatory to a number of international conventions, and that if you're going to use any of the international conventions, you would need to check that the UK was a signatory to them. But they are quite powerful, and they're where you'll get to the High Court with them, because they're on grounds of appeal, and they are points of law that you can use in the lower courts, which are binding on the courts. The courts cannot rule against them. If they do, that will give you access to to a judicial review. But it's whether the High Courts are going to be acting fair and impartial and allowing you through. I've found that they're putting blockers up and trying to stop this at every instance what they can. So today we're going to talk about council tax, the liability or the scam. First, you'll receive a notice of amount due, which is always in advance. Second, you'll receive a final notice. Then you'll move on and you'll receive, well, you won't receive the complaint, but you'll be told that the complaint was made to the court and you'll receive a summons. And then from that becomes the liability order, and then finally comes the bailiff. Now, Robin and Issa's case basically was about failing to provide information for them to take wages or assessment and attachments of earnings order because they'd obtained the liability order. Now, this was because Rob had allegedly acted unreasonably in not supplying this information because it's without reasonable excuse. They're the key words that's in that statute, which is where your defence comes, is without reasonable excuse. Well, Rob made numerous requests to a variety of sources, right, which we'll get into a little bit through this. He received demands from unknown entities. What was caveat emptor became a display of criminal offences by the council and their legal services and the courts, which it's clearly exposed. Where exactly are the officers of the court and where is justice? This was a saying from one of the Lords, which was, not only must justice be done, it must also be seen to be done. Now that was first said by Lord Haworth, I think. It's on your slide, but it's not reaching the bottom. But Norberger said it, and that was back in the... Lord Hewitt, he was the originator of the saying back in the early 1900s. But Lord Norberger's, or Neuberger, whatever his name is, he's picked it up. Lord Denham said it in the past. And I think, you know, the last time justice was seen to be done was also back in the 1900s when that saying came out. Since then, it's just been a copy. So Rob's made numerous requests to a variety of parties that are including, but not limited to, Greater Manchester Police, the Home Office, Wigan Council, Wigan Borough Council, Wigan Borough Council, the Wigan Borough Council, Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council, the Valuation Office Agency, and many more.
Yeah.
Now, this was one of the responses that he's received. The screen's not too big on this, it was bigger on mine when I tested. But this is from a response from Greater Manchester Police, which recognises that Rob is asking them, who are Wigan Council who are making these demands for council tax? I'm sure for anyone who's in this, who's in the Wigan area where Rob is, if I'm going to pay council tax, I want to know I'm paying it to the right party. And that's where the doctrine in common law, which is caveat emptor, which means buyer beware, you're to conduct your due diligence. So if Rob paid Wigan Council the council tax, and Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council, who were the correct party, came along a week later and said, hang on, that's owed to us, he wouldn't have any recourse to say, well, I've paid it to Wigan Council, right? Because they'd say, well, that's not the correct party, you should have paid it to us. And he'd have to pay it again, mm-hmm. twice. But because of the system that they've set up, which is full of manipulation, full of deceit, and it's like a big web, which is of a number of corporations all cashing in the one district area. It's like it's been broken down into a number of elements. Now, this is clear that he is making this, and this is dated the 11th of February 2013, which is right. There is a whole bundle of these documents that Rob gave to him, which clearly show there must be at least, I'd say, what, 300, would you say, in your bundle? In the letters and documents. 300, going on for years, and it was a reasonable request at first, which has then sort of exposed and uncovered what is going on in this area with the council. Now, GMP, has anyone seen that new song, by the way? GMP, good song, though. But GMP are basically now, because he's making the inquiries, they're fishing to see whether there's a criminal offence. They're saying, well, whether it may be an offence or may not have been investigated by GMP. So that's an indication that Greater Manchester Police are already investigating Witten Council or have done so, and maybe they've decided not to prosecute because the brown envelopes are getting bigger.
Cyril Smith's still in the frame. Right.
This is the complaint that was put into the court. Note who the complainant is on this document. The Wigan Borough Council. How many cases in one day? 1,179 cases in one day. The court slice of this was £3,537. And that is that this is the sums that someone's worked out when writing this, which is 1,179 cases times by £3, which is the court's fee, and that equals 3,537. I didn't write that and neither did Rob. This was disclosed directly from the counsel to me whilst I was defending Anise in this court case.
What's notice in there as well, the regs say it's a justice clerk and we're saying that, or a magistrate,
well,
a legal advisor.
This is a legal advisor, and this is what I'll come to this. How much did the council make at this session? Does anyone know how much the council would have made in that session? Anyone has the guess?
50 quid a shot.
60 quid a shot, yeah?
52
quid a shot.
60 quid is it?
A shot,
65.
Right.
So we've got 1179 times by 65 minus 3,537 for the court's fee. This is the council running away with a big bag of swag. And that's how much, in total, the council charged for one day's hearing in Wigan and Lee Magistrates Court, where it was rubber stamped. And this is exactly why we need judicial oversight into what's going on. Because whether you believe or not where the council tax needs paying, I believe that to a degree there is a certain amount that needs paying, because we do need to have the communities upkept. There does need to be some form of tax. I personally, I work in businesses and I believe in that system. But some people don't believe in it. I'd be open to any system as long as it's, well, how can our kids be safe on the streets? I've got five kids, they're a worry for me. I've got family members, as we all have, and they're a worry for me. But this is major fraud, because this is happening 15 times a year, 16 times a year. This is not once. This is not a one-off hearing for a year. This is about every 5 weeks or 6 weeks. Now, Wigan Council is one of the smaller authorities that will take the cases to Wigan and Lee Magistrates Court. The likes of Liverpool Council take 4,500 cases a day. Section 34 of the Council Tax Administration and Enforcement Regulations, subsection 7, allows them to charge for the reasonable costs incurred in issuing the summons. Now, unless you think 73,000 is reasonable costs, then basically they're in breach of that law, and what we've got is blind justice going on. Council's just left it behind it for the...
Is this money being shown on their balance sheet, by any chance?
I haven't seen the balance sheet, but I don't need to. It's a fact. You know, if this wasn't a fact, I'd eat my own shoe.
I was asking that, but I'm asking... Is it seen on their balance sheet?
Okay. It will be on their balance sheet, okay. But their balance sheet, they'll be operating as offshore corporations. Okay. Right? All these, you've got to ask yourself, why would they get these liability orders? Because if they're taking people who are either not going to pay, or can't pay, or won't pay, right? Then what's the point in getting a liability order to send the thugs around to do all? What does that earn them? Why are they putting the costs at that? Well, that liability order will become a security. And to me, then that is, I haven't uncovered this, but to me, all them securities are then traded on the international market, because all these councils, we were taken over. For people who say, well, you know, Europe is bringing in more laws, Europe's been dictating our laws since 1972. When the European Communities Act 1972 came out, that is when all of our councils were disbanded. Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council haven't traded since 1984, and yet they are the billing authority. So who are Wigan Council? What is their legal status? What capacity are they acting in? And this is what everyone has been avoiding on the question, because we've stuck to the point and we've stuck to the matters of fact on it, and we've been asking for specifics. Now, this is an alleged summons. First time I've seen one like that, and I've had loads. 3,537, it says there, Wigan Council has asked me to issue a summons. Well, if Wigan Council issued that summons, who have they asked? This is the date of the hearing on the summons, is the 16th of July 2013. The cost is here. Again, it's small on the screen, but that £65 is what the council have charged for generating that piece of paper.
No, for what? Asking him to do it.
Well, they haven't asked anyone, because Wigan Council actually do it themselves. So who would they say Wigan Council has asked me? To say Wigan Council has asked Wigan Council to issue this piece of paper. Yeah. That's what it should say.
Well, the other one was the Wigan Borough Council.
Yeah. The complaint was laid for the Wigan Borough Council.
Well, this is now Wigan
this is now a summons by Wigan Council.
It's a different entity.
A different entity. If you don't understand, everything is a legal entity. You're a legal entity. You're a legal entity. Everything with a different name is a separate legal entity. So, therefore, if any company, then they're acting as an agent of the principal. But you need to establish that they are acting as an agent of the principal. If I phone up a bailiff's firm for you, they won't speak to me until they get your authority. Why should we speak to bailiffs until we see their authority?
Just put a wig on it and it's...
Give them a good slap. The court responds to one of Rob's letters, which he sent in, the contents of which are noted, they say. Now, the court have stated in this that they simply facilitate the hearings. So what does that mean, that they're facilitating the hearings? If they're taking £3 to summons, the only thing that you can say is that basically, you know, they're taking a backhander to allow the council to come in and use the court under the pretense that it is a court established by law. So this would then take you back to your rights in the Human Rights Act, the European Convention on Human Rights, the International Bill of Human Rights. There shouldn't be any punishment without law, and this is not law. At this case, they just took the money, £3,537. It's an easy job for them, just to basically open the doors and let all the council people come in. It's called blind corporate justice. And I call it blind corporate justice because it's done blind. No one knows what's going on, and it's corporations that are doing it. These two people are fraudsters, Mrs. Tracy Hankinson and Miss Jackie Lowe. These are the people that are writing this letter. They know this is against the law, but still they're getting away with it. This is not simply them having a delegated authority to issue a summons. No one's got delegated authority to conduct judicial acts. So Regulation 36 and 56 is what permit the billing authority to request the financial information about you. This was the letter that basically triggered the prosecution for Rob, because this is where they requested the information subject to a liability order. So this is allegedly because a court established by law has adjudicated the matter and afforded you a just and fair opportunity to be heard. So who's the prosecutor in this case? This is now the summons. So this is the second summons, sorry, so you don't get confused. The first summons was about the council tax itself for the liability or the hearing. This is for a summons for failing to basically supply the information that was requested by Wigan Council on the 2nd of December. The prosecutor and the informant in the case is Wigan Council. It's clearly written there. So where does the alleged authority come from for Wigan Council to bring this prosecution? Who is a charging authority? The regulations do not have any stipulations for charging authorities, only billing authorities. What law permits Wigan Council, a private corporation, not the billing authority, to buy access to the judicial system and purport to be a court of law? Because that is exactly what they're doing. Everyone, even the police, believe that this is an order granted by the court. We have spoken to many police officers that are really starting to come round, and I've got phone calls, Craig at the back over there with the red dot on him. He's been making a lot of phone calls investigating this to the bailiffs, and we've been preparing transcripts because we are preparing court action against the bailiffs. This taking on the council and taking on the hierarchy is going to be a tougher task because the Attorney General will always step in and declare null prosecute. Now, you have rights then to basically go for judicial review on them decisions, but that's because it'll go against public policy. Public policy is an EU directive shoved down our throats by either the French or Brussels or wherever it is and whoever it is that's in charge of this. Mainly, I think it comes from Israel, but there we are. This is a statement from Mr. Paul Michael Lee. He's a witness and a career criminal as an enforcement officer for, who is it? He doesn't even know it, but he works for Wigan Council. He claims a liability order was granted on the 19th of July. Now, if you remember the slide about four shots ago, it was the 16th of July. So now this statement is tendered into evidence, and it's basically a criminal offence to tender a false statement into evidence, especially if he has the records, etc., to check these details, because this is supposed to have been done and checked before it's put in. He doesn't state when it was saved, right? He states in this, he states that the court confirms a liability order was issued, right? Then he says that the notice was sent out, but he doesn't say when the notice, the liability order, was actually saved. Now, does anyone know what the due process is in law? Does anyone really understand in a simple form what due process is? Due process is basically three things. Notice, which is your issue of your summons. The motion, which is the complaint to the judge and the judge. Mm-hmm. And then the order. That completes due process in three simple steps. So if fails due process, if they make an order and they don't save that order on you, every order made must be saved on you, though. You can't act on it. It's not an order unless they're given. Mm-hmm. It's pretty much like me saying it. And now you know what I've just said. You can't do it because some other entity is sending a letter out and telling you to do it. So when people are arguing these points, it's simple. Is stick to the, when you're arguing on liability order, stick to the very beginning and don't move off that step. You know, there's so many errors. I could have made this slide be about 20 hours with all the evidence that's in it. I've had to shorten this down from what was 1,000 pages of evidence to 120 pages of evidence for the court bundle, to now 40 odd slides, which is 24 on this case. It's not easy to break it down. And if you're gonna ramble on about all the issues in a case, it's gonna give the judges an easy avenue out, because it's like, oh, you don't know what you're talking about. Give them one at a time. Treat them like children, because that's what they are. They really don't know what they're doing. So you've got to direct them to what law you're saying, support your arguments, and stick to that point. Now, this is the defence statement. So I don't know how many of you have seen this format of a defence statement, but this is the recognised format. These are available on the website for the CPR and justices.gov. So what you're looking for is the criminal forms. Now, this basically will be a format that the judge who's sitting in his chair will recognise. So this then triggered the hearing before the district judge for Rob's case, which before that may well have been with a bench of lay magistrates. It may well have been coming with a district judge in any case, because they may have assumed a sort of free man angle might be taken, or they was basically going to be able to railroad over his rights because of not knowing the rules and procedure to the liability or the process. There's always a defence to every claim that someone might make against you. There's not always impartiality. And then it says, or justice. So this was the defence that basically is the second page to that first page that was put in. Wigan Council is not an authorised building authority, was put in there. The legal capacity and status was requested in here. It says the defendant requested formal confirmation of the legal identity and capacity of Wigan Council, and also requested information relating to the exact nature of the relationship between Wigan Council, Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council and Wigan Council. The Valuation Office Agency recognises Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council as the only billing authority. Now, this has basically been put into the defence, so it's another point. It has been confirmed by the Valuation Office Agency that they recognise Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council as the only registered building authority. Therefore, as there is no formal relationship between Wigan Council and the defendant, then there cannot be a duty to perform or any other such obligation. Because there's a duty to perform based upon the statute. The statute is only triggered based upon the liability order. If the liability order doesn't exist, then there can't be a duty to perform. They've asked me to perform this duty a million times, and I've been begging them to take me to court, but they never did. So when I got the phone call from Rob, it was, hey, hey! This, the defence is on to you. The defence also submits that there is no such liability order in existence or in the possession of the claimant that has been made by a member of the judiciary, which basically goes on to say how many requests have been made. So this is giving them, by putting this in, it's giving them the opportunity to respond and rebut what is being said. So they are now requesting information that's protected under the Data Protection Act, because your personal details are protected. And only if you have that duty, which can only be to the correct building authority, should you be supplying your personal details and financial information. Every single case of council tax in this country is fraudulent. Every single liability order, I am yet to see one. I've got one here, which is pretty much the closest I've ever seen to a liability order. Now, if you want to see what a real liability order looks like, then you'd go to the Council Tax Enforcement Administration. Council Tax Enforcement Administration and Enforcement Regulations 1992, and you'd go to Schedule 2. That will give you a sample of what a liability order should contain. It's a shame the council can't find that. Action Fraud was another company that Rob had basically looked at. They're a private organisation, Serco or G4 are running it, and it's where the police are now outsourcing a lot of fraud cases and they're dealing with it. But Action Fraud and corporate fraud are one and the same thing, they're just robbing us blind. Fraud upon the court was mentioned and pleaded within the defence because of the misrepresentations and the failing to disclose the notices upon the defendant. So then you need to put in statements of the witness, which the witness in this case is the defendant, Anise Austin. So basically what you're doing in the witness statements is you're keeping it brief, and all you're putting down is the points that you're intending upon which to rely on what you're saying has happened. Inquiries were made with the Valuation Office, who've confirmed basically that the only authorised building or charging authority is Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council. Warnings from other government departments, because Action Fraud have something on their website to say warning about government scams or departments or agencies that are purporting to be from the government. So, you know, the question of this defence was, did Rob or Anise fail to give this information without unreasonable excuse? You know, it's quite clear, and the evidence is surmountable, that there was definitely not an unreasonable excuse. He simply wanted to know in what capacity Wigan Council were acting as they were the building authority. You would think that the court would also be interested, seeing how this was highlighted to them. And if they didn't know what was going on before, well, I'd imagine that what was put in would be a bit of a shock, and they'd be wanting to re-look at what they're doing, because the delegated authority and the powers that they're giving out is supposed to be conditional upon the person being fit to use those powers and exercise those functions, which is being proved in this case that Wigan Council is not fit for purpose. If I lived in Wigan, I wouldn't pay them a penny. Without unreasonable excuse. So now, here is another letter from the court. After we have saved the defence papers, the witness statement, there was also case management papers. That's basically to get a case management hearing, which is to ask for what you're going to ask for. A lot of people turn up a trial and say, well, they haven't given me this, they haven't given me that. If you don't follow the process and the procedure, the court will just run you over. They're going to run you over anyway, but at least you can expose what a sham the system is by following their procedure, doing everything in accordance with the way that they want it. And then they do have difficulty, because I've seen judges squirming in the chair with some of the things that have been laying onto them, and I've had Crown Court judges not being qualified to deal with me. Absolutely amazing sagas that's gone on through some of the court's stories that I've got. Can't see what that says. Crossed over. So this is saying, as the as basically now, as you've served the defence statement in the case, it appears to be your intention to plead not guilty. No shit, Sherlock. Right? So this is now saying that basically that may I draw your attention to Section 8, Criminal Procedure and Investigations Act 1996, which allows the prosecutor, in this case Swindon Council, 14 days to respond to provide the information to you. Now this is because there was supposed to be a hearing on the 11th of February. That hearing was now postponed. The documents were served into the court on the 29th of January. Considering the bringing a criminal prosecution, and this is now a serious charge which can have serious effects on someone's well-being or livelihood for a long time. You know, if you've got a criminal conviction, it can affect insurance policies, it can affect a number of things. Basically, they should have the evidence ready. There should be some primary disclosure to save. This is clear demonstration of how pathetic these courts are and how little they know about law. Because Section 8 is not for that use. The letter doesn't have a case number at this stage. So we're already in a criminal prosecution and yet there's no case number, it's just a JLMT reference number. Section 3 of the Criminal Procedure Investigation Act is triggered upon service of a defence, not Section 8. Section 8 is basically where you're trying to make an application for the prosecutor to enforce the prosecutor to carry on with their continuing duty to disclose. They can make an application under Section 8 of the Criminal Procedure Investigations Act to not provide you with the information due to public interest immunity. That's what Section 8 is there for. If they did do that, then you would have every entitlement to say, okay, well, I want counsel to see the papers, to assess them, and an independent counsel would then get involved to assess the papers, see them, but you may well still not be able to see them. The only reason they're going to get public interest immunity is if it's something to do with the Terrorism Act, as long as the argument's presented right, because there's disclosure authorities that allow you the right to see every bit of evidence that they're putting into the court in support of what their case is. There's too many presumptions and assumptions being made by the court, and too many people allowing them presumptions and assumptions to be made right. And the only way that we can stop them presumptions and assumptions is by demanding the earlier stages of evidence that we need. At this point, there hadn't been any disclosure whatsoever. So we got a notice of a new hearing. There's no court insignia. That is basically Rob's address, etc., being blanked out. But it looks like an official court document, but it doesn't have the crest of arms or coat of arms or whatever it is. So it's listed before the district judge now for a hearing on the 21st of February at 1:45, and it's basically to find out what is your defence and whether you know what is in that statement. Because Rob has put this statement in at that time, they didn't know that he's got anyone else is involved or who's going to turn up a court with him. So this letter is basically a fishing expedition, as was the hearing on the 21st, to see whether he can just trample over his rights because he didn't know how to get any redress. The duty alleged on the accused arises when the official liability order is granted. So this is basically failing to supply the information in accordance with Regulation 56(1) and 5 of the Council Tax. And that's because of the liability order. So we attended court on the 21st of February. And when we got there, basically, we were standing outside, was we, Rob? They didn't have a courtroom. They didn't expect us to turn up. We were there for about half an hour waiting for them to convene a courtroom. Ushers legging it left, right and centre. They finally got one together and Anish was taken into the defendant's box. I went in to represent her and was put up with the same old usual wall to stop me speaking, which was I didn't have rights of audience and I didn't have the right to address the court. I argued on behalf of her that she was an international because she's from Latvia. That she was afforded the rights for representation of her own choosing, that I knew all the rules and procedures of the court, I knew the law, and I could act as a friend of the court and basically assist it in providing the evidence and the forms that they'd need, so it wouldn't be so much of an argument of free man or wasting the court's time. And I used the overriding objective of the court as a rule to be able to do that. I was granted full rights of audience on the day, and then the prosecutor proceeded to supply what their case was and just went on. I then addressed the judge and told them that we had not served the liability order. Without that, due process has failed. There can't be an obligation upon this point, and we didn't believe that there was a liability order until such time. So we asked for directions and requests for the documentation, in which point I had the directions ready that I would serve if Wigan Council served the liability order and other documents that we required within 7 days. I'd supply a skeleton argument in accordance with the law, with authorities that I was relying on, and statutory instrument within 7 days from that date. And then the council, we were going to allow them 14 days to respond to my skeleton arguments because I knew it was going to be quite technical for them.
Was that a mistake?
Now, this is Judge Kadeshi. I must say, first though, he was a fair judge. He was. He's as corrupt as the rest of them because they're all letting this scam go away, so make no mistake. But at the end of the day, he was fair at this hearing, and he did afford them his rights, and he did act in accordance with the procedure, although at the end of it he gave a wry smile and said, I won't be reserving this case for myself. So these were the directions that came out afterwards. Notice how the court changed the prosecutor without either an application or a hearing here. Now this is here. So you've got WBC. Now that's Wigan Borough Council. So now they're given directions for Wigan Borough Council to serve the amended witness statement from Mr. Lee, which was due to an administrative error where you got the date wrong of the liability order. It's great how they get so much leeway with all these administrative errors. The defence, this was to be basically, he put, and relevant enabling evidence, including the liability order, by the 28th of the 1st, 2014. Now, that's unheard of because I've never had a judge order the direction for the disclosure of the liability order. I've never been in this situation before, but every time I'm turning up at court to represent someone on these liability orders, the case just gets adjourned. Need to sort that screen out. Noise. It's all gone off again. Right, so where's the other? I'll just sort of do that. It is contempt of court to fail with the directions of a court. So now all of these things should be followed because otherwise it is contempt of court. For us anyway. That's what it said on the slide when it popped up. Gary Crawford, an assistant director for the legal services, his name is here. He's employed by Wigan Council because, as you can see now, even though there's directions, we've now got Wigan Council writing back out to us, enclosing the evidence that Wigan Borough Council was directed. So, you know, this is a very confusing matter for anyone because who is making this claim? They appear confident.
What's your point that outside the court listing was Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council versus
WMBC.
Three different bodies. Four.
Paul Michael Lee's updated version of a statement. The first was incorrect and tended into evidence. They would have obtained a criminal conviction on that false statement, and they often do, because these are the mistakes that they're making all the time, and with no judicial scrutiny, then all of this is going unlooked at and just overseen. The date's now changed to the 16th of July, which is the date it should be. They still claim a liability order was granted on the 16th of July 2013. So there's still adamant within this that the liability order exists. This is Norma Corbett, who's a statement. She works for Agilities. I don't know who that is, but this is basically outsourced administration. So they're now paying another corporation to send out letters. Because that's all fees do, send out letters. So that means, you know, another company and corporation is being run on the council tax bills that's being charged to all of us. Another career criminal. Where is the confirmation of service of the liability order? She confirms that the liability order summons was sent out. She confirms that the liability order information request was sent out. But she doesn't confirm that the liability order itself was ever sent out. This was what they put at the top of their bundle, which was legal evidence. That should be signed. But poor Michael Lee, I'm guessing he knows he's a criminal because he wasn't wanting to put a signature on it. And this was the evidence that he submitted to the court. Are you ready? This is a liability order. Now, that's got to be the sloppiest liability order I have ever seen in my life. I have been trying to be conned with some liability orders from these courts, right? But this is just outright. That's an embarrassment. And the government really should be taking action on this, and the courts, because we all know that they're already in disrepute. But it's things like this that they can't even hide their own scandal more. They're employing complete moronic folks.
It's their inability to lie order, rather.
Yeah, definitely a lie order. I don't know what that is. That just doesn't even make any sense. Lie. I mean, is this really how stupid we believe we are?
Their ability to lie.
Is this how ignorant we've become as people, that none of us are getting these liability orders and none of us seem to know what to do about it, or we're standing there and we're arguing? They make us look like we're crazy because we stand there shouting free man, or trying for some sort of remedy in the court, trying some arguments. And this is what we're crying about.
I've been asking for one of these for 3 years, and it took us having to go to criminal court to get disclosure under a criminal case to get...
That's not disclosure, because that is not a liability order. That's a piece of paper.
But you ask them nicely, and they won't provide it. You know,
if they're prepared not to be a liability order, then they're failing to comply with the court's directions, because that is not a liability order. So that still remains open, that they failed to comply with the court's directions, and that's
contempt of court.
Cases being prepared where this is going to be, we'll instigate a case for malicious prosecution against Wigan Council on behalf of Anise, and she'll get compensation for it. It's a hands down win. Or is it that the court's just a sham? People have gone to jail on the basis of this. Right? Is this right, that people should lose their liberty? You know, a couple of months ago, there's a guy on Facebook, 72 years old, being put in jail for 28 days for refusing to pay council tax. You know, it's not surprising people will refuse to pay council tax when it is just a sham and a scam. Was you going to say something then?
Yeah.
I thought you was putting your hand up, stroking your head. So this was the document that accompanied the liability order, and this is the court list. So in this, the total number of counts is 1,195. Yeah, that is here. 53 plus 20 plus 1,121, yeah, which is 53, 20, 1,121, equals 1,194, right? So it's not 1,195. So now we're even losing cases. We can't even count up simple maths. And these are adding up your bills. This was the skeleton argument that I presented to the court in defence of Rob Ford, the legal arguments and the preliminary issues. Basically, you're setting out and you're putting an introduction on the skeleton arguments into the case to explain what it is for the judge. The main issue, so you'd put down a number of issues. Now, you need to get discipline when putting down issues, because a lot of people have put 100 issues, and there is hundreds and hundreds of issues. But you've got to identify the smaller issues and the ones that you can identify the law that goes with it to try and defeat what their claim is and show that they're acting outside of the law. So one of the main issues here was, is there a valid liability order granted by a court established by law? We then move on to making submissions, which is basically putting down what the law is, what's going on in the council, and putting an argument together to say Wigan Council are not the correct authority and therefore there is no duty. Now, here are the people that are in charge of Wigan Council. Peter Smith is a director, and Joyce Redfern is an executive. Now, she's recently changed to...
somebody else. This is off the credit report.
This came from... we'd done a credit report on Dun & Bradstreet, and basically couldn't find anything anywhere for Wigan Council except on Dun & Bradstreet. And we got the corporation number, but they're just in the same buildings as Wigan the Metropolitan Borough Council. That's the correct one, isn't it? So each of these is a separate legal entity. Wigan Council, Borough of Wigan, of Borough Council of Wigan, the Borough Council of Wigan, Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council, the Wigan Borough Council. Now, I could have done a lot longer list than that, because there is about 12 legal entities all claiming to be Wigan Council. You need to get out and have a fight and see which one of them is really the council. If a liability order was granted, it must comply with CPR 40.2. Now, this is, do you know that the liability order is done under civil procedure rules? Does everyone know that, or do you just not know that? Yeah. Because a liability order is, it's deceitful, because they're telling you it's done in the magistrates, and therefore you believe it is criminal matter. It is not a criminal matter. It is a civil matter, and it's done and it's governed by the civil procedure rules. There is no legislation that allows them to not do it by the civil procedure rules. The civil procedure rules is about this big, and it's 2 books, and we replace it every year to add for confusion, because it's amazing. There's a trick to reading it out. Now, CPR 40.2 states, I need to get closer, every judgment or order must state the name and judicial title of the person who made it, right? So you've got to have the name of the person and the judicial title. So Wigan Council have also produced evidence in support of their application to say that they're the billing authority. So now, with the evidence that they've submitted, that is outright fraud unless they can actually prove that they are the billing authority or they're some form of agent with permission. So basically, it was, I can't see that right. Paul Michael Lee made the complaint, and now he's failed to disclose the copy of the liability order, and therefore the complaint's invalid, a nullity, and must be struck out. Every order must comply with the CPR. The court must seal a copy. So CPR 40.4 states, where a judgment or order made has been drawn up by a party to the and to be served by the court, the party who drew it up must file a copy to be kept with the court, and sufficient copies to service on him and on anyone else who's a party to it. Once it's been sealed, the court must serve a copy of it on each party. So liability orders are supposed to be held at the court, because every order that's made by the judiciary, right, is to be kept in the court. So when a court's telling you, we don't own copies of the liability order, well, that means it wasn't made. Because if it was made, it's got to be kept.
Yeah.
So therefore, there isn't no case to answer or no claim with any bailiff that is coming out who can't produce a sealed copy of a liability order issued by the court. And if the court don't hold it, then it's not legit. Unless someone can demonstrate some other law. The legislation that they're using, which is the Council Tax Administration Enforcement Regulations, they say what it needs to comply with. And that's set out in Schedule 2.
Can that be a photocopy of the seal?
They can use whatever they want. They can do photocopies. I mean, at the end of the day, what you want is you want the seal on it, you want the signature on it, and you want to be able to identify who made it. Because if you believe that that was made incorrectly, then you have got an option to challenge it. Now, if that's a fraudulent document, that could be exposed, because for a judge to issue the order, then he's got to actually listen to what the application is. And you can't make an order without hearing the two sides to the story, because there's always two sides to the story. In this case, this was different to mine. I've got thousands of these. In this case, a niece was due council tax because it's her property, if you believe in paying council tax. But she wasn't disputing the fact of not paying council tax, because they sent letters sent to Wigan, met with the Metropolitan Borough Council, offering to make payments to them and to them only, because they are the correct billing authority. Wigan Council kept harassing and kept coming on, and all that they was trying to do is make sure that they're not going to get billed twice. Whether it's a scam, whether it's a scheme, whatever, if that's highlighted and they've got some legal way of operating in doing that, then they shouldn't have any problem with disclosing that to you. But by standing there and ignoring you, where's the transparency? You know, where are they being open? Where are they treating people fair? They're treating us like prisoners and like slaves. I personally have got tons of fun.
Would you differentiate between the seal and the stamp? They're often...
I wouldn't, because I don't know. I don't really understand what difference it makes, to be honest. Because it's all crooked. So who cares if there's a seal on it? And who cares if there's a stamp on it? Who even cares if the judiciary sign it? You know, at the end of the day, it's if it doesn't comply with this, if it complies with this, then you've got to look for another avenue. But if they're not complying with this, you've got to think, well, there's a reason why they're not complying with it. Is it actually legal what they're doing to us? Is the amount that they're pressing onto us legal? I've got council tax bills for properties I don't own. Now, the question I have to ask is, how are you getting a liability order on a property that I don't own or I don't live in? What type of a... what type of a... I was told not to swear. What type of a judge, right, is just issuing these summonses? Now, if you go to... If I went back to the other slide, which left out, 1,179 cases... Let's say you broke that up, right, and you said the judge has got to sit there and he's got to scan read all that information, one judge, right? It would take him spending 1 minute per information 18 straight hours, right, without a toilet, without a cup of tea, without stopping, reading them informations, if he spent 1 minute on each piece of paper. Do you think that's happening? No, and that's why there's no liability orders, because what happens is they just sign a front page saying a new court list, and that way they're not liable for any actions that happen afterwards. But it's a clever little trick for the judiciary to say, well, we didn't give you the liability order, because your claim is against the bailiffs and against the police. It's not against the council. You can make a claim against the council, you can take that on. Try and make a claim against the court, it's going to be even harder. Why bother? Right? We attack the bailiff and the police because they're the executive branch. They're the people that go out and they're the people who enforce these orders. So if they're enforcing them, then you're entitled to a claim, especially if they haven't got the foundational evidence to support what the claim was. They will not have a defence saying, I was told to do it. The council told me. It doesn't, you know, it's not going to matter. They're going to have to establish it, but it means that you've got to take the claim to them and stop defending, start to make claims. Every computer printout must be accompanied by a certificate as well. So that's another thing that's missing. In the evidence that was given to us, we had lots of computer certificate printouts, etc., saying this. Well, according to the CPR, and this was something I only come across when dealing with this one, it states that every document that's coming from a computer, which is basically the evidence has been come from, there should be a certificate to say what computer they come from and that computer's working and accurate.
Really?
Yes. You see, if you read the law,
the
law is there to protect us. It is our ignorance that puts us in the position we're in. And because we've been so ignorant for so long, then throwing a few shouts out now and then, here and there, is not going to make the courts turn. Because it's not just us that are ignorant. The judges, you know, they've been sitting on their perch for so long, and you can actually see, you know, it's revolting to look at them, seeing how bored they are when you're getting dragged to court and you're trying to get a fair hearing. To them, it's just like, yeah, what have you got to say? You know, and they're not interested. It's just monotonous what's going on. They're just continuously just acting against us. But no one's pointing them in the right direction. I would say I've probably educated a lot of these judges by putting this in, because they probably haven't read it themselves. They haven't had to, because no one's pointing them out to them. So the multitude of entities is certainly not transparent in its dealings. And this was put in the conclusion. So to conclude the argument, we put down that the authority, Wigan Metropolitan Borough Council, has deliberately created a streaming network of legal entities which they attempt to enforce an alleged liability. The result is confusion. It's a commercial structure that the claimant has failed to comply on the most basic elements of the rule of law, which amounts to a serious abuse of the court's process. I spent ages getting this presentation right, you know. So they won't be on
work.
This was the end of the skeleton argument. So basically this lists the CPR, what we was relying on in the case. It lists the statutory instruments and legislation, because we used the Greater Manchester Combined Authority Order 2011, which, you know, you should read that document if you're from this area. It pretty much is telling you that it's all private corporations and they're all taken out of the pot and they're all in it together. there isn't no rule of law. Not that I can. There's a rule of law, but we will have to enforce it on them or expose them for not using it, because people don't see it, especially people. You know, it's all right for what you've got is people who can afford access to high priced solicitors. They get great justice. They get law, because they've got the most expensive barristers dealing with their cases. So we don't get to see that. So they see the system as being fair. When we go, we're left with ourselves. We haven't got access to the justice. And if we can't afford a solicitor, we get a crap one, because the best ones are all right in the bills and parliaments. Because if anyone comes up, Lord Mansfield was a great defence, QC Mansfield, he was a great defence barrister, getting people off with lots. He destroyed cases. He now writes legislation. Because they basically come after whoever can beat them, and then they bring them into their gang and into their game. So you put your list, your authorities, you'll put them in. Whenever you're using an authority, it's important not just to list the authority name. You must quote the passage that you're relying on in the authority as well, and point to the paragraph that it's in. You also have to enclose a copy of the authority. Don't just quote it, because if you're doing that, then they will ignore it, and you won't understand why they're ignoring it, because you're putting the legislation. It's binding on them, but you've got to quote what passage you're relying on, why you're relying on it, and put the name of the authority in there too. The law can be used as a shield and a sword. So this is demonstrating, if you're getting someone bringing an attack against you, you need to find the legislation that supports what your argument is, as well as the authority. There's no point in us crying if they're walking over our rights, if we're just going in and saying, well, what's right and wrong? It's, you know, court, it was said by one of the judges, court, it's not a game. Again, no shit, Sherlock. I treat it, it's like war. You know, when you go into these courts, they're not acting fair, they're not acting impartial. They're there, and everyone's a member of the bar except you. Right? You're the outsider in that room. You are the meal ticket for all the parties that are in that room, because they don't get paid unless they find you or they get something from you, especially as the defendants. Civil matters, okay, they get some court costs. That's just to run the administration. There's a lot of backhanders goes in court. There's a lot of backhanders going on with barristers, giving them to judges for favoured judges, for favoured judgments, especially when it comes down to the banks. But again, that's a different presentation to them. The common law is the law of reason. So, you know, if you can find a common law argument to support why something shouldn't be used, it's the reasoning behind. Common law was used to make legislation. So legislation is supposed to be reasonable as well. Just because it says it, it doesn't mean it was meant to be used in that manner. So you've got to go back and think, well, why was this statute created? What was the reasoning behind the man who made the statute? Because I don't think that they'd get them through and get them passed if they said the reason is what we're using them for today. It was more so to use them in order to make sure people were treated fairly, to make sure that we had options to go to court and a bit of redress, to make sure that everyone acted in accordance with the rules and procedures were followed and everyone got a fair trial. Now, equity sits above both of them, and I'm not too good on equity yet, but I know that that sits at the top, and equity will not allow a statute to cloak a fraud, and a lot of these statutes are fraudulent. Mm. It's a bit like the Proceeds of Crime Act. That's a fraudulent statute because it's being used in a fraudulent manner, i.e. someone getting pulled over on the street, having £1,000 in the pocket, getting it took off, and if you can't prove it, you lose it. That's just legalised street robbery, and that goes into the police's pocket. But that's against common law, because that would be conversion, and that's where the claim would come in, for conversion, for them taking that. Because you can't have proceeds of crime if you haven't done a crime, can you? You can't just say, well, balance of probabilities, it's for a crime. And that's what they're using it for. That also goes in the civil court.
I'll just say again, because equity, my understanding of equity, is the conscience of the court.
I've got equity I've got the basic concept of it.
Yeah.
Right.
But
getting into the court of equity is a tough nut.
Yeah. And is it a court of equity when you go in there? It should be the conscience of the court.
All the courts will say that they operate equity, just like all the courts will say that they operate common law. And they do to a degree, because equity is, you know, you have equity in your house, you have equity in it's basically goods, isn't it? And yourself, you know, you've got equity in your own body, really, you know, but I've not studied that area,
no,
yet,
no,
and
no,
I'm waiting
really,
on it.
I'm just saying, because it's conscience, right, yeah?
This is basically, after we put in that skeleton argument to the court now, they didn't serve us a response, they didn't serve us a skeleton argument, and they sent us this letter. Now, this letter was dated the 7th of March, right, the same day that the skeleton argument was put in. However, for some reasons unknown, it never came until about the 19th, 18th or something like that.
Yeah.
So basically, they backdated this letter because after they've considered the argument, they decided to discontinue the prosecution at this time. A letter has been sent to the court notifying them of this decision and requesting that the hearing be vacated. But please be advised that this relates only to the prosecution for failing to supply information, and that a liability order was made at Wigan Magistrates Court. Well, where is it then? You know. So this is them still continuing, despite it being right in the face that it doesn't exist. Now they're withdrawing and discontinuing the prosecution on the basis, but the liability order still exists. So it means, you know, the regrouping and the thinking what other scam they can come up with and how else to attack it. Mr. Gary Crawford, though, he'll have his day in court. Because this is, you know, if he is a member of the Law Society, he shouldn't be, unless there is a liability order that he can establish and prove, then this is again fraud and abuse of position. And that's where that rests and goes off. So now, basically, we've got the system. In theory, the system should work, and the rules are there, and the law to support it. Imagine a virus in a computer. Well, imagine the same for the law or parliament, because that's exactly what's been going on for, say, the past 100 years. We've got a lot of idiots in parliament that are just basically taking bungs off corporations to put in legislation, pass bills, and that's what we're suffering from now, because the European Communities Act broke up all the councils into small districts, and now they're all corporations, and they're all operating for the benefit of the shareholders,
yeah,
not for the benefit of the people in the area,
right,
that they're working for. So they, as big corporations, get to basically send bills through to MPs and pay little slices of money to them, backhanders, it gets it put in, it becomes a legislation. So, you know, the law that we've got, or the way the law should work, and the British justice system, is a good justice system. It's been copied all around the world. The problem what we've got at the moment is it's not being used correctly. The judges and police and court security, are they necessary? I'd say so. But I wouldn't say that, you know, you can go from one extreme to the other saying no, because right now, no, there's not a single judge I'd say deserves to be in the seat they're in. But do we need it? If crime is committed against either of us, would we want it? Of course we would. You know, we'd need to have somewhere to get redress. We need to start using them and start using the law,
yeah, yeah,
in our favour. Lord and order.
What about the common law courts that's being set up?
But how do you enforce? Which common law courts are you talking about? Are you talking about
the ITCCS, set up common law courts. There's one in Coventry, just been recently set up, and somebody in Manchester setting one up. Apparently, they have their own law enforcement court officers who will be trained up to carry out.
And is this official?
Well, it's common law courts.
Yeah, but
it's from Hague. It's from the European Convention of Hague.
Not William.
I'm not sure, because I don't see how that would be established and be able to operate.
They'll ignore it
because you think of this, they're a bigger army, right? You go round to a fight with a big corporation like the United Kingdom, right? Then you're going to lose. You know, at the end of the day, let's not disrespect them and underestimate what their capabilities are. They've caused war all around the world. They've instigated wars on a whim. Tony Blair is a career war criminal.
Right.
He's a warmonger. Right? The Constitutional Reform Act that came out in 2005 was brought in by him.
Yeah.
Right? That law should just be wiped out because it's unconstitutional. The change in everything. The Lord Chancellor's oath in that constitution is basically to the benefit of the court system and to the effective running of the court system. Well, you know, they're taking away all the rights in the constitution. Blair has been established as a liar. Now, they held the International Criminal Court on Blair, didn't they? And the Queen and other people, and that's a common law court in Brussels.
And in Malaysia, he's wanted that too.
In Malaysia as well. Well, they're setting them up, and people are trying to do it. But okay, that to me is it's everyone's trying to make an effort, and you know, eventually, if we can all mould together, maybe they will be enforceable. But right now, in the situation we're in today, we can't use them courts to enforce anything for us. We can try, we can basically go along and take part in what they're doing. We can try and present evidence to them, and we can establish someone's guilt. But that's all we can do. I mean, I don't need to do a trial to tell you that these people are guilty of fraud. Right? I don't need to try. I don't need to go into court. I'm telling you it's a fact. I've seen the paperwork, and unless they respond with, I don't even see how they could possibly respond in any what way with any paperwork that would substantiate their actions, you know, allowing them to do what they've done, taking people to court. They're buying access to the justice system. The courts are involved in it because the courts are covering for them. But now they're all running in, okay, just leave it. Now, I turned up at this hearing with a barrister at the end. We got a cost order because I'd done all the work and done all the case. But then coming to the end, they withdrew the prosecution. The court never sent out any order to say that this prosecution was being withdrawn. Just Wigan Council, because they can control the courts. Then basically, they're just allowed to vacate the proceedings. You or I couldn't just vacate proceedings. No, just forget it, right? So I had Rob phone them up on the morning of the hearing, which was supposed to be on the 28th of March, to check whether it was on the listings. It wasn't on the listings. So I arranged for a barrister to attend to apply for costs, because I knew full well that if we just turned up on our own, they wasn't going to give us a courtroom. So therefore, what they're doing is they're acting as if, well, there's no punishment to them. So they got a surprise, because when we turned up anyway, what was there? Four police officers, a bundle of court security, all standing in order, but we had counsel, right, and a barrister walking. And when she comes in, they're all looking and scratching their heads and going, what are we doing here? Everyone's going to a corner. Next thing, I said, because of the counsel and because of this, then the police go, the security dispersed, and this is waking up barristers now, because she couldn't believe what had happened. Because she was looking and saying, what's going on? She's a part of the system, a part of the, you know, a part of the law society, as it were. And she's a junior barrister. But her father is a quite a high barrister. He's, you know, they're quite established, and they've got a firm of chambers. So this was the first step and stage to opening the eyes of solicitors and barristers, because they looked at my arguments and the bundle and the case which is here. I mean, you're preparing bundles. I'll take these off. This was the bundle that was entered in to the council and the court. So you're putting an index on the front. Yeah. So you need to have it neatly, because you've got to be able to navigate through this in an hour to an hour and a half in a hearing. You might get half an hour to say what your pieces are. So as long as your bundle is structured right, this is an indictment, but you can't see it yet. Because this has all been now with counsel and barristers, and they basically handed me this back because I've asked them for an opinion on the lawfulness of this judgment, on the lawfulness of Wigan Council, on the lawfulness of the corporation that they're operating and collecting all these findings. And the barristers have gone like that, oh, right, and dropped it, because they've said it will go against public policy, right? The Attorney General will 100% step in to close this down. They've looked at the indictment and they've said they've not seen a bundle like it. And they've said basically that it is excellently put together, which is thanks to Samira, who puts it together for me. And the documents are drafted right. Yeah, there are some errors in there. There's some things that need changing. But they've looked at it and said, yeah, if you would class them barristers as a jury, they said guilty as fuck. Right? There is no way. But they said, I don't see how they can get out of that, what they can do and how they can allow it, because they said it would mean they can't see how they could collect council tax anywhere in the country, because they would have to then do it. There is a method that's laid down in law for them to follow, which is also in the Council Tax Administration and Enforcement Regulations, Section 34, Section 35. You know, they seem to just jump straight up to Section 36 and 56, which is the enforcement, right? They're forgetting the beginning of how to obtain that order and what they must do. Now, it's a case, this is only through people's, you know, how many people have exposed that? It's been here since 1992. right? We're now in 2014, and the amount of people I've seen fighting these liability orders, I've been trying to, I've told them it doesn't exist, I know it doesn't exist, but I've never had the liability order saved on them. I've had lots of alleged ones, and I've wrote to them, and I'm not exaggerating when I say I've got a stack of files off the floor, this high and this wide, documented evidence with detailed fraud. My case is different to Rob's, but I took Rob's case on because I couldn't get that. I've been wanting them to instigate these proceedings against me for 6 years, 5 years it's been going on, and they haven't done it. So I took Rob's. Now, beating Rob's was easy because there wasn't a liability order and the duty wasn't on them to do it. Beating mine is just, there's not even a defence. I got 39 bailiff letters for one property, right? One property that I don't own. And I attended court in March the 21st, 2012, right? And I took control of the court. I demanded the manager. And he said, there is no manager. I said, I can tell that. I said, but I need a manager to be brought here so as I can deal with this matter now, because I am sick and tired of getting told to leave and then have to come back. And basically, I got in front of a court, got in front of a panel, they said today, no evidence. I said, well, what's your evidence? Well, what are you saying about it? I said, I'm not saying nothing. I said, what's your evidence? Show me your evidence, and then I'll say something. Well, the council can't be expected to do land registry searches on every property at £3. I said, oh, yeah, so all of the people in Merseyside can be expected to be rounded up like cattle and dragged down here at a cost to them to save you £3 from doing your job. I said, don't think so. And I wouldn't leave the court. They had the security in there, they had the police in there, and I just wouldn't go. Right? Wouldn't let any of them come near me either. I'm not going to say what I did on camera. But that then, the solicitor for the council had to run across to Millennium House. He had to go and get a land registry search printed. The first time I heard this saying, this is when I realised this really is a scam. First time I heard this saying was, he who searches must prove. The clerk of the court, I'm in the court, I'm on my own. Magistrates have all bailed. Police have now gone. Security have gone. I'm standing there with the clerk. Good on you, lad. It's about time someone stood up to these. And
but
he said,
he
was sitting there like, no one said, I can act, I assert myself, and they call it intimidating. I just won't be walked over. If you want to put me in jail, put me in jail. If you want to put me in a cell, put me in a cell. But I'm not going to be treated like a muppet, and I'm certainly not going to be told what to do by some player.
Yeah.
Right? And that's the simple, you know, it's the basis that I'll work on in the courts. Now, after all this, the council's solicitor comes back and says, we're withdrawing the case because it's not in my name, the property, right? It's not my property. Now, since that date, I've had 39 bailiff letters. I've had 7 liability orders. I'm getting constant demands. I've had a bailiff call round to my shop on the 24th of September, a couple of the others. I put it on tape that they're all corrupt. You know, it is absolutely ridiculous what's going on. They phone me up and refuse to charge me. Right. And I'm still, last week, getting bailiff letters. And, you know, I'm going to end up, I think they're pushing me to react with violence. Because this is now, either I learn law and I take it in, but I see what they've been doing is pushing me and pushing me and pushing me. Because if I react in that manner the way they want me to, I will be the one that looks bad. It'll be, look at him, look at what he's done. And they'll use that against me.
Yeah.
So I thought, I'll get smart and I'll learn how to deal with the court. I'll look at the procedure. Every case I deal with will take me days and days and days because I'll go through it and pick the bones of it apart, but always start at the beginning. And you know that's where you've got to start. I brought along some transcripts. This is a transcript of a call with the court where I'm asking, let's have a look. I say, hello, I'm wondering how I obtain a copy of a liability order. This is the operator in the court. Liability order, what's that? Well, it's something you grant. Right? Hang on, we're Liverpool Magistrates Court. Is it to do with the magistrates? Well, yeah, it is to Liverpool Magistrates Court. It's where the council send out the summons for council tax. Okay, right, it's Liverpool City Council, you've got to ring for that. Well, no, it's the magistrates who issued the liability order, isn't it? You go, I'm not sure. I'll put you through to the pre-court. You know, and this is goes on, these are absolutely ridiculous. The guy in there who I'm speaking to, who is Ian Lang, he's supposed to be one of the people that is issuing, he's something to do with the clerk, but he is like running the pre-court, if you like. Now, I was speaking to him, and as I'm talking to him, and I'm probing him, and I'm not letting him move off questions, He says, we're not legally trained. I says, I know that. I said, otherwise I wouldn't be getting these documents. They just bail. None of them can answer anything that's coming. I've got hundreds of phone calls, and the evidence I've got to prosecute these, right, is unsurmountable. It doesn't even need to go to court. It's literally just enter your plea of guilty and take your sentence, because there is no defence to any of it that's against me. And that's where that come in, because of course, I don't own these properties, and I'm getting these orders. But when I was in court, I'd look at people sitting there like sheep, just rounded up in the corner, sitting there waiting for the punishment. And I've been in there, and I said, what are yous all doing sitting here? I said, why aren't yous getting seen? Right? And I'd rile it up. They don't like me in the court, because why should you? Every other business in this world operates with an appointment system. What's that? 10 o'clock at court, everyone. You know, do they not know how to put people in the diary? Have they not got anyone running the diary? But people don't answer up, and people aren't speaking out. And that's what led me to then start thinking, well, they're not just picking on me here. And I'm able to fight them, I'm able to assert myself with them. And I looked at other people that were struggling and thought, it's just not right. You know, what the misery that they're causing with tenants, with housing benefit applications, council tax, and everything else is just not on. And why people put up with it, I don't know. And that's why, you know, I've put everything I've got at risk. I've moved on from my business there to do this business now. And I work this 7 days a week, 14 hours a day. And to date, I haven't charged a penny to anyone. You know, so I've been doing it it's a case of, if we don't do something soon, right, we will never have the opportunity to do something. Yeah. Because it is already being taken over. And that is my point.
Start is the first letter, pay your council tax. The end is the bailiffs trying to get through your door. That's the process. Right. It appears to be a chain.
Yeah.
And there must be a weak spot in that chain, because people seem to be attacking at the beginning, right the way through it, and at the end as well. They're fighting it off, whichever way they do it. Which is the weakest part of it?
It's always the beginning, isn't it?
Where you say, where's the authority over me?
No, I wouldn't be doing that. It's the claim. Is if they're going to make a claim, I just leave them to go ahead and do it, right? And then once they, because what's the point in pointing out? If someone's going to make mistakes, right, and they're going to be your rival, arch rival, if you like, why tell them how to do it at the beginning? Right? Let them make the mistakes and then just null it at the end. Because if it's just the same way that this was, okay, the added burden is people are putting up with the stress and the pressure. I mean, what we're working is we're working to take claims against the police, against the bailiffs, because they forget the government, forget parliament, forget everyone else, forget all these councils. The council are not the people that come out and enforce the law, right? It's the bailiff and the police. Take care of them two bodies and you'll take care of the law, right, as a whole. Because someone can sit in parliament and say whatever he wants. If I can't hear it, I don't care, right? But if he's using police to come out and enforce it on my doorstep, then I do care, right? And this is the thing, is they can only use them people. You'll never get them coming out themselves. They sit there over a glass of whiskey, making up laws and rules and thinking of ways of ripping people off. I mean, Liverpool City Council are looking at now licensing landlords, £500 for 5 years per property for a landlord. They make out like landlords are the bad people. Well, I'll tell you what, landlords, they're taking more money. Where does that £500 go? Well, for them to oversight and judge you're a fit and proper person, who the
bigger pensions.
Right?
And bigger pensions.
Well, bigger pensions. Yeah, you know, everything about council tax is the pensions.
Yeah.
But it's one big scam. They're using that as insane, well, there's bad landlords about it. Well, a landlord, if he owns a property that's, say, 60 grand, will be paying a mortgage interest only of about 300 quid a month. Right? Then he's got his insurance. Then he's got his repairs. He'll only be getting rent about 450. Right? So he hasn't got any rent. So when tenants are complaining and say there's disappeared or something, but housing are paying it direct to the tenants and the tenant doesn't pay in his arrears, where's the landlord supposed to get money for it? You know, the only landlord in this country is the Queen. That's it. I'm a landlord, but I feel like I'm an agent for the Queen. That's it. Because I don't make nothing from the properties that I rent out. And I say to all my landlords and investors, because I deal with over 270 investors, which is why I've been able to fund and finance what I do as well, and help along with the meetings, because all of them landlords all know I act fairly with a tenant and a landlord. I listen to the two sides and said, okay, well, look, he hasn't got money. We can move you to another property. Right? Because there's no point complaining about something that's wrong. If it's wrong, it's wrong. But landlords have donated to me for what I'm doing and helped. To basically, because they believe it's right. I fight the corner of the people that are on benefits at the low end and cannot get access to justice anywhere. There's no bill to be charging with them. And solicitors, I mean, I was speaking to a solicitor, he was like, well, what's a liability order? I mean, that just tells you how much of a scam it is. They don't know what a liability order is because you can't get legal aid to represent Jordan the course of that. So there's no one with money's getting a liability order because, you know, they're on higher earnings, 700 quid, 800 quid, a grand. You know, for the year, they'll just pay. So they're not getting bought through the court system. So the people, it's not that they're ignorant and they're allowing it. They don't know what's going on because the system's being set up and it's being carefully segregated into little groups and corporations to keep it like that.
Just a point, in Sheffield, John Howard Ashcroft, who should have been here today, he has had several guest houses. What we've discovered over the many years, there are at least 10,000 cases. The council has been putting people into his guest house that should have a Schedule 1 offenders. But what's happening, the council are getting him to look after them at 280 quid a week, when the real bill should be £2,300 a week. And that's part of the money that's been kiked off by them. And also that they are registered as landlords themselves and they're getting all the benefits. And this is going into the group in the council. The other thing is that common purpose is the real hidden body behind all this. And so if you've heard of common purpose, you'll hear Cameron mention it frequently. And so common purpose is like the mafia under there. And this is all part.
There's loads of
Kerslake, who was the head of Sheffield, he's now the head of the cabinet, the civil service.
Yeah.
And Sheffield has been the major vanguard for all this corruption. But the 1,200 properties that Mr. Ebert had in Liverpool, I know he'll want you to have a look at that case because he says there's 10 billion that will go into the pot to fight it.
I'll have a look at it. Right. 10 billion, yeah. I'll have a look at it then.
We're mostly aware that these bulk processing centres exist. It's a huge one in Northampton.
Yeah, the Northampton County Court Bulk Centre.
Yeah, which is not a court, is it?
No.
And so what would be your recommendation about how to deal with judgment orders which get spat out by those?
Well, again, the same thing applies. Civil procedure rules apply, and I think it's practice direction 75 or 74 of the civil procedure rules that govern parking tickets. And in that, if you look through the practice directions, you'll see that it all comes from Europe. It's all instigated from Europe. This collection of foreign judgments. Basically, Northampton County Court Bulk Centre is not a court. It just isn't a court. There's a Northampton County Court, and then there's a bulk centre. Yeah. But what they're doing is they're robbing the title of that and that, and they're just merging them without merging the buildings. So they sit over there, and they sit over there.
So do you tear up the order?
Well, no, it's not going to stop the bailiffs coming out, is it? You see, I've been tackling these issues for some considerable time, and I've been trying to obtain copies of these orders because when you get one of them documents that comes out from the Northampton County Court Bulk Centre, it's pretty much like the liability orders can. It doesn't come from the Northampton County Court Bulk Centre. Yeah. If you read the bottom of it says drawn on the authority of,
yeah.
Right? So what it is the council draw it, the council sends it, the court don't even know it, you've got it, right? Until you don't do it, because then what happens is the council apply to register the judgment with the Northampton County Court based on you not responding to it. But if you respond, there's only one of four grounds that you can respond to it on. You know, it's, what do you mean there's only one of four grounds? And then four grounds don't involve, not one of them grounds is I didn't get that ticket or that's it, that's nothing to do with me. Because at the end of the day, they're putting these tickets on cars. Well, how many places are there out there? How many cars are duplicated in registrations? And yet there's no system that allows you to go and argue the points. But if you read the practice directions, they do say you can request a hearing by a district judge. Mm. Right? But it's unheard of. It's unheard of. And personally, I don't see why you'd request an order from me. I just ignore the letters. I'd just be writing letters and saying, I'll have a court date. That's what I've been doing. But the thing is they'll send bailiffs. It's different people will deal with different things in different ways. And it's for everyone to make their own decisions as to how that is. You know what? The yellow lines being everywhere. Some of them, yeah, okay. Again, the reason behind that, what did the man who made that legislation have in his mind when he's doing it? It was more a case of him looking at, well, okay, on this road here, you'll have yellow lines. Because anyone parking there is going to cause an obstruction to everyone that's driving up and down this road. It's going to be inconvenienced having to stop, wait for the oncoming traffic to go so they can get past. Well, there, you would class that as you've got a victim, haven't you? So it's the use of that line in that place is reasoned by the judgment, and that's what the regulation's for. But you know when you see yellow lines on big, massive dual carriageways where all you've got is a traffic warden sitting in a camp chair at the end waiting for, you know, them to basically come along. So as soon as your ticket's there, your car's there, he's on it, putting in. That's a revenue stream. Yeah, all they're using that for is to make revenue. That's an abuse of the process of what the legislation was put there for, because it weren't put there for that reason. It wasn't put there for revenue raising. It wasn't put there to be put and stop people parking on streets accepting there's pay and display. I mean, what's pay and display? I've done hundreds of Freedom of Information requests to them, and the information that they send you back is more like, will pay and display pay for the roads? Well, what does road tax pay for then? Well, that pays for the roads too. What's council tax pay? Well, pays for the roads. You know, what pays for what? Why is there so many different taxes? But again, there's you know, it's everyone's fighting the same things in these courts, and anything that's unreasonable on the road, in my view, I look at it and see whether the law is reasonable in the instance in which they're trying to use it. And if it's not, then they probably haven't got an official judgment, because that's what the law's there for. It's there to be reasonable, to ensure that we can all live together, you know, in a community without having to go out and resort to having violence with each other. So the system is there to offer some sort of protection or remedy. It's just, it's being misused. That's the only
you're right, you're saying that the best thing to do is to write and apply for hearing in front of a judge.
Yeah, you can apply for it to be a hearing in front of the
On the basis that you've got some defence, or that you don't owe it, or that
you've got
no obligation to the party that's claiming the money.
I wouldn't use the no obligations of the party who's claiming the money, because you know you've got to look at what the offence is. That's the same. Is did you commit the offence, right? And if you did commit the offence, was there a valid reason? I once got a ticket for parking outside of a school on zigzags, causing an obstruction. Now it was because of my niece being in the school and having an asthma attack. I would say that it was not unreasonable for me to fly into that school, park where I could, and leg it into the school in that case. And there certainly wasn't anyone who I was causing an obstruction to. So we wrote a letter to the chief constable and the fixed penalty tickets department. I said, can you define for me and advise me why you think it was unreasonable for me to assist in someone who was having an asthma attack, right? And tell me who I was obstructing, because there was no obstruction. They cancelled the PCR.
I can understand a case like that, but an awful lot of them are not to do with that kind of
thing. I know it's not to do with that kind of thing.
It's a non-payment a non-payment of a debt, say 750 quid, which had been sold by loan company.
It's already done then. It's already done. It's gone on. It's sold. It's sold. Right. You don't. As long as you don't enter into a
contract. It's not collectible.
But
are you saying it's non-collectible?
It's non-collectible.
If the entity has assigned or sold it to another party.
It's third party.
It's been discharged.
Right. It's been discharged. It's been discharged.
You write to him and say thank you.
There's plenty of stuff that's been charged, and you just basically.
And it's just the heavies in the people who have bought it tongue in cheek for
what's
10,
it for?
10,
is it for the mortgage?
10% in the pound. They want to collect 100%, so they go the heavy way through Northampton.
Well, they bought out the bailiffs have bought out the new taking control of goods regulations now. That basically allowed the police to assist and do it. I mean, they don't allow
enough. That comes under the Credit Consumer Act. You say we noticed it.
Exempt of it. We bought it.
And what about parking?
And you regulate.
So it's exempt from that?
The Seizure of Goods Act only covers credit consumer goods bought or services in credit consumer.
Have you got a sound?
Not council.
But then it wouldn't cover parking tickets either.
But they're going to use it on parking tickets, because what they've started doing now is actually the police are actually stopping people on the road because there's an outstanding something, and telling them that if they don't pay, they're going to take the car.
Yeah, they did that the other day.
And they can't take the car. They're not allowed.
Whose name's Farnham?
Well, they don't seem to bother anymore about whose name it is.
But that's only because it's all like you saying the law is there for you. Right?
Well, I don't think it is, to be honest.
Yeah, but you don't think it is because you're expecting.
Whatever happens, it just doesn't happen.
I beg to, I'd say it's hard to find justice. I won't dispute that. It is hard to find justice, right? Because there's a certain way and a method in which you've got to go to find it, right? But you can't wait for someone to come and do it for you. You can't wait for, you know, so just for you to send some letters into them and then act. You've got to enforce it. You've got to become the investigator, right, the drafter, and the enforcer all in one go, because you've got to do the stage of looking what the claim is, investigating the claim. When I read a letter, it takes me hours to read it because I'm dissecting. It's sentence by sentence by sentence by sentence. And I'm understanding what the meaning is in that sentence. Not just what I understand the meaning to be. I'm interpreting what the meaning that they're using is by looking at the law that they're trying to use against me, or looking at the law that they're trying to use against another party, and then finding the remedies in that and using that. But if someone took your car, for instance, right, that would be a claim. Your cause of action would be conversion. Because they're stealing your goods for use of something else. If they're going to split, what they do is they could potentially have a defence to that claim, and they say, we've got a warrant, right, that allows us to take this vehicle. So, okay, present your warrant, let's see whether it's lawful. Then look at the CPR rules and the procedure and see whether the warrant is lawful. If the warrant is not lawful, your claim for conversion will be successful, and you will be entitled to damages, and you can go for an injunction to get the goods returned to you, because it's all on the basis of whatever is lawful. Now, that's not the, you know, you're not getting that everywhere, and yet you will get judges that'll just ignore it, and they'll rule over it. But it's like this, it's, are you just going to give up, or are you going to continue to fight? Because that's the option that we've got.
Well, do you know what? There's a couple of people that I know, and I won't name names, there's a couple of people that I know who have gone on the route of full non-compliance. Even when the bailiffs are knocking at the door, they just completely ignore them. Refuse to give names, nothing, and run away.
Yeah, they did. The bailiff
cannot talk to you. I mean, it's recently happened to my other son, and I was on the phone, so they were giving him a case, and the guy's just gone away. Because no one will admit to being Tony Clark. And the guy can't find out who Tony Clark is.
Maybe a video you've been recording.
Sorry?
Maybe you've been recording.
Yeah,
been
I'm
video.
Not bothered. He's not bothered either. I'm not bothered. I'm transparent.
Yeah.
But no one will admit to who Tony Clark is. And Tony Clark's been stood there and he's going, no idea, mate. And the guy's had to go away.
Was
so how many times is that guy going to come before he's going to get fed up, because he can't find out who Tony Clark is? And to me, and there's a couple of other people who have done it, I've done it on one occasion, I've stood there and gone, don't know what you're talking about, no idea.
And they can't force entry.
You just stand there
and going, who do you want? No idea. Go away, no idea. And there's absolutely nothing.
They can do
it. It's not remedy, is it? It's not remedy. If they go to the next person next door in the next street who doesn't understand what you're talking about, they'll force their way in.
No, it's not remedy.
Yeah, but they can't force.
They can't force. But this is where you have a claim.
I can go and I can rob your wallet if you'll let me. Right? But if you won't let me rob your wallet, I can't rob it, can I? Or there's going to be force and there's going to be a tussle, and I could end up getting arrested for it. If someone uses force against you and someone breaks the law, you can't just sit back and expect the police to come in and do the job, because the police are useless. A chocolate teapot is more useful than the police.
Yeah.
Right? They are idiots. They just go out and do what they're told. They don't understand law, they don't understand anything. All they understand is the specific instructions they are given day by day to go out and do. Right? So your access is to the court. You have got the access there, but what's becoming a problem is the courts are finding ways to push us out, because there's so many people trying to go to court, and they're trying without having the right evidence, without pleading in the right manner, and without putting it into a detailed, documented, paginated bundle, right, that the judge will listen to. Because imagine how many people have been in front of the judge, and he's like, you know, you'll get lots of people going there, whereas he'll just be like, yeah, 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 because they really have done something, they really are causing problems, they really do owe this or they owe that, or this has happened and that's happened, and, you know, every one of them are claiming innocence and claiming this, that and the other. You know, I've been there myself, I've been guilty of some of the things they've said, and I've gone, well, no, because I don't think it's right, it was wrong. But at the same point, you're going to have people going in there with genuine stuff, and then they're not listening, because you can't present the argument, and because the argument is not being presented, they're putting you in the same class as what all them other people are. So it's a case of us smartening up to get the message across to them in a shortened fashion. You know, this court case would take me, this would be a matter of a week's trial to try and get across what I was getting across there in a short time. Trying to narrow down your arguments is the hardest thing. I can type a 30-page document in a couple of hours, right? Doing a 6-page skeleton argument will take me 3-4 days. Because I'm having to research the law, I'm having to do the big drafting of it, and then I'm having to look, okay, that's my emotion speaking, that's my anger speaking, right? I'm having to identify what I'm using to speak in the letter, and then strip all that out and just stick to facts. Because the only thing that matters is the facts, and that's it. So you're looking at the facts. If you want to bring a case, right, your first thing you should have all your facts sorted. You need a chronology. Right, so you'd make a chronology of what has happened, yeah, and just keeping it to the very bare minimum, right? Then you're going to do a summary, right, of what your case is. So a quick introduction as a paragraph, what it is, how the case came, right? What is the evidence in the case? What are you saying? What are they saying? Right? Just down to a page. Because then you're building it, you build your summary on the facts. Your story fits in around that. You see, this is how they're able to manipulate the legislation with lots of people, because they can say that you did this, but there might be 3 facts in a case, right? And that trial might go on for weeks, because what they're doing is they're building a story around those facts, and they're trying to make the story fit the facts, instead of the facts fit the story, right? It's backwards. This is the police could not catch a cold. Honestly, what they do is they find the crime, right, and then they find the victim, and then they fit a crime up to them.
Correct.
You know, and that is the way it operates. A lot of people don't see it. A lot of people, I don't really go out that much on the street. I won't, because they've tried to set me up on a number of occasions. Now even my own wife said to me, "Did you do it?" But I look that type of guy, don't I? So I've got it going against me from an offset. Well, I've got it going against me from an offset. But that's because I'm helping a lot of people, yeah, in fights in the court. I'm fighting the council tax for a lot of people, right, who can't afford to pay. I'm fighting it for myself because I don't know it, right? But they don't like that. Someone coming up and being able to present arguments and cause and basically make them play the game in accordance with the rules, well, they're as blind as the rest of the people because they don't know the rules. So when I put arguments into them, it's like, oh, we'll have to adjourn now. I've got to go and do some reading. Right? Because we don't know the law. And it's, you know, I don't know what else to say about it.
Why don't we do follow your example of this?
How would that work? Because what would happen there is they're going to step in. So you take a class action against every council. What you've got to look at what your aims and your objectives are. Are you trying to destroy and demolish all of the councils in the country? And if so, who is then going to administer all the looking of the streets, cleaning, all the jobs? People can say whatever, but I started their meetings in July or something last year, right, and invited people as volunteers and doing this. A lot of people are too busy wanting to watch Home and Away and Neighbours and Corrie and EastEnders, right? I work 14 hours a day because I'm not working. I feel I'm at war. I can't, yeah, get up at 5 o'clock and go home. I mean, it's like, this is a war, and it's a war of words, yeah, and letters that we're being suppressed under. And every person that wants to work that 9 till 5, or go out and just basically, you know, put a couple of hours in here and a couple of hours in there for fun, well, they're not taking it serious. You certainly wouldn't fly over to Afghanistan and just start walking through the streets like that, oh, I'm getting off, see you later. You know, because you're in the firing line. Now I'm in that firing line because of the fight that's been going on. It's continuous. I literally will not put my guard down. Yeah. I don't see my kids, and my kids have to come to work to see me, and most of the time I'll stay in the office or I'll leave at 9 o'clock in the night. Because they are bad and you need to get down. But what you've got to look at is, if that was to happen, well, what would we be left with? Because someone's going to step in if that happens, and will they be worse than what's there?
It's not about bringing the councils down. There is nothing wrong with the system. What we've got to stop is the corruption of the system. Mm.
So that's individuals?
It's a class action. Because the thing is, Neil, people are not educated and they don't have the knowledge, whatever it is, to put together a document like the one you've done. They probably could have the other time. But people don't do that. But if everybody used it as a template...
The worst thing that you can do...
What you're doing is exposing it and making a lot more people at the same time.
The free man argument used to work, right? People used to go into court in 2009, 2010. That was the big day for the free man. Everyone was going in and saying, I'm common law, don't stand under that statement. Yeah? And the court did not know how to deal with it because they'd never dealt with it before, right? As far as I could see from what was going on. I come onto it because I was in court one day with bundles and someone said to me, you know, we shouldn't even be in here, like, you know what you're doing. We shouldn't even be in here. Couldn't lay in fire and all this. And I'm like, what are you doing here then? You know, it's the first question you're going to ask because I didn't understand it. So a couple of days later, I'm looking on the internet and I see it and I'm thinking, oh, I'm going through it. Next thing, it's like giving a man a new toy. I'm in the courtroom. Don't stand under that statement. But I'd learned a little bit of it. Then I started to tell people and teach it. And the amount of people I've seen bullied and fail at it. And I end up going in and doing it for them. And then you're feeling obliged. Lots of people are left. But the courts have since, because it was new, some people got away with it. You've got to be strong in the character to be able to pull that off. Because you are a slave unless you have got your consciousness back. Unless you're basically awake, wide awake, and you're in control of yourself. And understand that they can still, you know, you're an enemy combatant. That's what your name is. Name means enemy, right? You're an enemy combatant of them. And they're going to do, you've got to be able to take being put in yourself and stand and say, I still don't care. I'm still not doing what you say because I'm in charge of me. And that's how far, literally, you will have to go to do that free man route. Now, the reason why that it's become like that is because there's so many people going into court trying to pull it off who didn't have a clue what it means, and most people still don't know what it means. You know, they understand the concept, and they understand the broad and, you know, the shortened arguments of the broad structure of it. So they go in and they try it, and it makes a mockery of it, because those that can't then pull it off, well, they make it harder for those who can, because the judges can't determine who's got it right and who's got it wrong. So using anything as a template, no one should be giving anyone any templates to go and use that, because that's just the lazy way for people to say, oh, okay, yeah, I'll just use your letter and I'll put my signature on the end and I'll put it in. Now, if I'm asked any questions about it, yeah, I won't be able to answer nothing. I'll have to give you the ring. Right? Because that is what makes the arguments fail. This is why the courts are like this, because of people's ignorance to learning it. This is not a fight where you can just learn it dead easy. No one is going to have a solution or a remedy to say to you, oh yeah, look, this is dead easy 10 minutes. People have got to wake up and be vigilant in themselves and start to assert and educate themselves and arm themselves with this, because if you're operating to a script, the minute someone takes you off that script, you're lost. You're lost. And then you're going to stumble trying to regain where you are. And they're masters. I always describe court as like a play. It's a theatre, right? Because the judge is not a judge. He's a person, just like the rest of us, right? And wrong way to use when talking about common law, but as we're classed, he's a person. The barrister, you know, he's a person, he's not a barrister. When they go home, they're all just normal people like us. But in there, they're in the arena. Where we go wrong is we go in with our heart, not our head. So it's a game of chess. You've got to be able to look at what they're going to do, how they're going to do it, what they're going to bring about you. And you've got to work them moves out before you make your move. Yeah. So you're playing them to play into your hand. So don't play them too strong at the beginning so they get it right. Because you want them to make mistakes, so you can point out, God, that's enough. It's void.
Neil, I want to take you back to about an hour ago.
Yeah.
Start again.
Rob Beast, where you were saying a letter came through from one of the Wigan versions of the council saying proceedings vacated.
Yeah.
Right? At that point, they will have notified the court that they don't want to play the game anymore, and they will have given Rob a notice saying, basically, we don't want to play the game anymore.
Well, that was that letter.
Yeah. Do they not have to have your consent to dismiss the proceedings at that stage?
Of course they did.
So you turned up back at the court on the
and we got
on the prescribed date because you haven't given them consent to vacate the hearing?
No. They vacated the hearing. Rob phoned them up on the morning, right? Said, phone them up, see the listing. Rob's phoned them up, there's no listing. See if we're going to get a court. What did he say to you, Rob? He said he wasn't going to give us a court, didn't he? Doesn't matter if you turn up.
The court has decided to discontinue the hearing.
Yeah, right, okay.
Waiting counsel withdrew the case.
No order from the court, but this is now where the court have just pulled themselves into the scam, right? By trying to protect the counsel and saying, no, it's not. Of course, yeah, they can vacate proceedings, but they've got to give you notice. And it's not for the counsel to give you notice, it's for the court to give you notice.
That's right, that's the whole point I'm trying to make. If they want to vacate the hearing, they have to apply to the court to vacate the hearing.
Yeah, but this is what we're faced with, is they don't have to apply to nothing, because they're all in it together. The way they should do it, yeah, they're supposed to make an application to the court, right? Or send a notice of vacation, and then the court can send that the other party has requested to vacate proceedings.
Yes.
Do you have an objection?
Yes.
Like, yes, I do, because I want the costs. Right? So, and that's what, they basically cancelled all the hearings, this guy, and told us we wasn't getting one. Now, when we turned up with a barrister, well, a whole different ball game happened.
The court has a duty to...
Well, they have to, don't they?
Yes.
So basically, they've gone in, because this just shows you, what the only thing that we can do to make change is try and expose the situation that we're in to these solicitors. Because I've got a couple of solicitors on board now that is looking at what's going on and what's being done, and it's opening their eyes to it. And I'm showing them how they can, because now I'm using a business side to say, well, okay, I'll show you how you can make money from it. I'll take cases, and I'll deal with some of the cases just on my own. But if there's a case where there's something in it, I'll do the preliminary work, and then I'll pass it to you, and you do it. But you don't get paid if you get costs. You do not get paid off the clients.
So
and they're open for that. Right?
When they'd opened up the court that day, because they were eating humble pie, basically, you turned up, forced the situation. And so they've had a duty of care to open up the court. And
I don't know. You know, to make it easier for them, what it did is, because we were sitting there, and I didn't want to put the council in. So you've got to remember that we've all come from Freeman. We've been pushed, we've been oppressed, we've been kicked while we're down, right? We've been on protests at all round courts supporting other people. These barristers and that, a lot of them haven't seen it and they don't know it. And what they do is they talk about us like we're an absolute bunch of freaks. And, you know, we don't have a clue what we're talking about, right? And this, that and the other. It's a simple thing for us is we've got to highlight it to them. But we've got to gently highlight it to them. So on that day, I can see, I walks in, she's felt intimidated, she was quite heavy pregnant, and she's looking around at the police and everything everywhere. So I said to Rob, I said, we don't need to be here, do we? Right? I said, because now you're just going to go in and get the order for costs. Right?
So
said,
did you
get
an order for costs there and then?
Yeah, no, we went to make it easy, because the court are in a situation now where they've been caught in a scam, right?
Yeah.
And one of their society members has come along and has gone, well, what's going on? Because do you reckon a barrister's ever been to a council tax hearing? Do you? An ex-prosecutor? Because that's what she is, right? So she's turning up for cost and didn't understand what liability orders were, right? Because she's never been to represent someone who's facing a liability order, because it's a civil matter, and that's why you can't get cost or legal aid for it, and then it comes to criminal matter. So all they're doing there is they've had to allow, because otherwise they're going to have to explain to her what's going on. She will know corpse agency. This is a hearing that's been set for today. You haven't sent any notice out to the other party to let them know, and more so, you haven't even set a date for cost hearing, because surely if someone's took by someone else, then they're entitled to cost.
So did a judge sit there?
I don't know.
Day?
You see, they did it there and then. But what it did to make it easier on the court and easier, because see what happened there, right, is counsel's come in, They think in these courts all operate proper and right. They believe in them, right? They're not all as corrupt. Some of them are just plain stupid. Some of them are corrupt. And some of them really just go along with what the rules are and they believe that that's what it is. Now, when they're dealing with the court are treating them in accordance with the rules because they've got to, right? When we're dealing with them, we're treated not in accordance with the rules because they assume we don't know the rules.
Yeah.
So when you establish you know the rules, then they're still going to act and they're going to push away. They don't want their, you know, someone seeing it because this is a scam that they don't want exposing.
Right.
Because the court is now in a situation where their court in bed with the council doing dodgy orders. So to make it easier on the court to allow the courtroom and her not to be going, well, hang on, what's going on here? And she just thinks she's being dragged into the middle of a war because that's literally what it is. She's got to be scratching in. I said, we'll wait outside. So she can just get the hearing. So she then got the judge and the clerk to convene a court, went in, applied for costs, and got the order.
Did you grant a specific cost there and then?
Did no grants the cost? No, it's not specific.
No.
The taxpayer pays that bill as well. You know, where, even when a private corporation like Wigan Council makes a cockle, right, and the court and them are committing fraud, we get an order for costs out of the national taxing team. Right?
Yeah,
now that comes
from all
of our taxes.
Did you and Rob get your costs?
My costs, yeah, because basically I've gone through the case, had meetings with them, so there will be costs. I don't know what they are yet, because it takes 3 months to get paid as well. See, this is why else is, you got to look at what the case is, how long it takes to get paid. And this is why people, or solicitors, won't take on dodgy cases or things that don't really come in, because they've already got to wait back. And when you think solicitors are getting £300 an hour, the Law Society charges £110 million per year, right, to the solicitors' members. Insurance companies have put the professional indemnity insurance up on solicitors from £25,000 a year on average last year to £50,000 a year this year, which is cutting them away. They've cut down legal aid by about 30%. The police station fees for attendances for solicitors to turn up the police station, that's been cut by about 14%, which means that you're just an easy target because the only ones that are actually going to go along with that is this, the absolute crap ones. You know, all the good staff, if I was a solicitor and a barrister and I'm going to be doing work, I'm getting in my car and I'm driving to London, I'm going where the money is. I'm not sitting around here. If I'm any good, I'm definitely going up there. So all the good ones will go to where the money is, and that money is in the bigger inner cities, the City of London, Surrey, Essex, etc.
Do you think it's worth it?
Because we haven't got any good solicitors yet.
Well, I'm wondering if I
myself.
Do you think
it's worth it?